And we publish both here on ISTP website, on ZIA website, and also this event is recorded somehow. It will go, as they say, to the YouTube site. I know we will organize some kind of all materials in one, including videos, all lectures, and also all your posters and all list of participants and the winner and the winners of the poster sessions as well. So if you want to win, please send it. Because if you don't, we don't have it. Okay, let us continue now. As I said, that the basic simulations of the, it's like balance and temperatures and flow rates and other basic simulations are really basics and can be done relatively simple, even with using numerical methods and CFD codes or subchannel analysis, but also by hands, because the first reactors were calculated nearly by hands or with this logarithmic ruler without before calculator even areas. However, when it goes to the transient analysis, it becomes much more complicated. And transients are, there are different types of transients. For example, reactor startup, which is very slow, can be considered as a series of several steady states. But there are accidental transients, which is a result of the accidents, and it includes design basic condition accidents, DBS, we say, when its reactor shutdowns normally, or it could be drop or release of the single contour rod that results in the power excursion, and also loss of one of all primary pups, but it's a protected accident, which is with normal normal shutdown. However, and this is what is included in the design and must be simulated in the design stage. But in addition, also for simulation at the design stage, we have so-called design extension condition accidents, which includes, okay, there are different terminology, I would not go to the details, but generally this is this accident that a severe accident that may result in core melting. Or core damage, or core disruptive accident, what we say. And that's what we want to prevent, or in generation four reactors, we want it, or innovative nuclear energy system, we want to practically eliminate this possibility and with core melt, and practical elimination means to create the design that physically eliminates the possibility of such event, or when it's physically impossible, to make the design measures which will lower probability of this accident to the negligible values. Not zero, but something like very low probability compared with other potential effects like meteor or, you know, which is, and then we call it practically eliminated. And it's one of the goals of the Generation 4 International Forum, Generation 4 Reactors. Nevertheless, I mean, not nevertheless, for this reason, we also should simulate, even those possibilities are practically eliminated, we should simulate also those transients which may or which result in core disruptive accidents, just to see what can we do to prevent it, how to mitigate it, and what potential consequences it could be. Of this is the most important and most dangerous is so-called ULOF, unprotected loss of flow. And it's most serious accident, and it means you have, you lose all your pumps, and the contour rods and shutdown rods don't work. So shutdown system does not operate. That's what happens with the reactor. Another severe accident of this type, I mean design extension conditions, is unprotected trip of power that could be related to the sudden, for whatever reason, drop or release of the contour, or full bank of the contour rods. So like all contour rods are out of the reactor, what's happened next? And another type of the accidents, as I mean, I'm counting only main one, it's a core flow blockage. For whatever reason, for example, we have some, let's say, we did not control oxygen carefully, and we have some pieces of oxides which are collected somewhere and then block the inlet of the fuel assembly, and that will reduce the flow rate, whatever, significantly, or even totally block the subassembly. Then, if you totally block the subassembly, what's happened next? It will melt, of course, inside. Cladding will fail, and fuel probably will melt, but will it distribute it more to the other subassemblies, or it will remain local accidents that can be mitigated as a result? So, and the loss of heat sink also, let's say, for example, for whatever, like decay heat removal system don't work, it's also kind of accident, and it's also transient, but let's say they're all in the different time scale. When your loss is very quick, it's several seconds, for example, the SFRs, for SFRs, and for like loss of heat sink and several hours, days, and so on. So to solve this problem, we will need, it will require coupling, calculation, thermohydraulics, neutronics, mass transfer, equation of states, and probably some structural material calculations, which you need how materials can survive this accident or not. This is very complicated multi-physics problems, and for this we have several computer codes developed, and I just want to show you several examples. Of course, we have no time to discuss all the details, but I can show you several examples how to. Let's take as an example of the Astrid, former Astrid reactor, which was presented by Christian 2 years ago here in Trieste. And this is very advanced, definitely one of the leading generation for concept. Even the Astrid is not officially part of this sixth generation for concept. I believe ESFR is of this. Anyway, this is innovative sodium-cooled fast reactor, which is satisfy all criteria for the generation for reactors given by GIF. So you have, it's a pool-type reactor here, and we have reactor is here, vessel is a big, relatively big vessel. Inside we have a core, which is, I will show you later. Then you have this vessel, and here we have a pump, which pumps coolant from the so-called hot plenum on the upper part to the cold plenum, and then via diagrid, the flow goes inside the reactor that is released as usual in the so-called hot plenum because coolant already hot. Then it is inserted in the heat exchanger, and from heat exchanger it's released already cold to the cold plenum. So it's not directly connected like outlet and inlet of the core via heat exchanger and pump, but you have heat exchanger and pump actually in different positions, slightly different positions. So it's also adds some thermal inertia to this system, so it's not immediately react on inlet, core inlet temperature does not change very quickly, remains there. And also, okay, then we have this intermediate loop, steam generator, or maybe other system, like conversion system to the electricity, and so on. So here we have innovative core design for enhancing safety features. As for the standard, let's say, classical SFR, the main problem, as we were discussing already, it's a sodium void reactivity effect. And there were several design measures, assumptions, and many numerical simulations how to reduce this sodium void reactivity or eliminate and or practically eliminate the possibility of the severe accident in such as a core. So this part is shows example of the simulation of the Astrid. It's the same picture from the previous slide as is simulated with SAS4A and CIMR3 codes. CIMR3 is two-dimensional safety analysis code, multi-physics, and in this case, we use two-dimensional version because three-dimensional would be too much for this system. You see, the core is again here. We have somehow simulate pump, heat exchanger, this upper plenum, upper structures, and the die grid, and the inlet is here, and so on. This is shows the temperature distribution at the nominal conditions in this core. You see that, OK, I will show them maybe more details for the core. So it's more or less simulated and at the nominal conditions. Now, what happens if you have the Yulov accident? Before we go there, let's explain a little bit about the enhancement on the safety, which has been done for this. This is one of the version of that. It is not, of course, final or official. It was published like 5 years ago. We can see. So the features of this core, as you might see, that we have core with different size. In this case, it's homogeneous, but it has different size of the fissile fuel assemblies here, and also it has extended sodium plenum, especially here is extended, and sodium plenum is extension of the sodium plenum. The purpose of this sodium plenum, so it's like more or less empty sub-assemblies on the top of the outlet, it's to, due to the leakage, reduce. So if you don't have sodium here, it will actually have negative reactivity effect. Because in the central part of the core, you have actually always, you always have a positive reactivity effect, which you want to avoid. But in the upper part core, we don't have fuel, but we have sodium. And if it's sodium voided, you have reactivity effect. So this is numbers like, so finally, total reactivity effect is positive. Even this plus one, and this should be like about 500 ppm positive. But we don't expect that the sodium boils immediately removes from every part. So what we expect, and what is the purpose of the upper sodium plenum, that since we have this also negative reactivity, sodium will boil in the upper part, because temperature in the upper part is higher than its maximum temperature of the coolant, and pressure is lower there, because also it's a little bit different altitude, I would say, height, so its pressure is lower, and also pressure is loses during flow, coolant travels through the core, it loses the pressure, so minimal pressure in the upper part, and since it's minimal pressure there, so boiling should, in principle, start in the upper part. And if it starts in the upper part, which has negative reactivity effect, then we expect negative reactivity will lead to the reduction of power and shutdown of the reactor. So the simulations were done for this. This plot shows core flow rates of the core versus time. So as you see, it's very quickly. Not very quickly, but relatively quickly, actually in a few seconds, pump stops. But then this flow rate becomes like about 10% after some time, 10% of the nominal, and remains on the nuclear circulation only. It's 10% of the nominal flow rate provides natural circulation, I said, natural circulation effect. Then when in this case, as you have very low flow rate, but still power is nearly nominal, a little bit less than nominal, you have obviously overheating, and sodium starts boiling in the upper part. Once it starts boiling in the upper part, you have decrease in reactivity here, and you have decrease in reactivity and decrease of the reactor power as well. Then, after some time, boiling stops because it becomes colder. Boiling stops. In this case, the sodium comes back again, and you have again 740 plus ppm of the reactivity. For some calculations, it should be like periodical process, like this, shown on this paper. So it boils and stops with the power a little bit even close to the nominal. No, sorry, it's reactivity plot. But there are several other cases, and as they're very sensitive, it shows sensitivity analysis. I will show you probably on this page now. So here shows the reactor power. This here, it's logarithmic scale, so actually power becomes like maybe 30% first thanks to the Doppler and something. After the transit, it first becomes a little bit lower, and then this process starts again. And let me show you. Autox. It should remove like. Okay. Okay. Thank you. So this slide shows the simulation. So we see time goes after the accident. And then you see in this area, the boiling starts. We have empty voided area. Then after some time, it stops because it becomes reactor power lower and becomes colder. But later, it's again. So sometimes you can see interesting effect, like it's stable, boiling stops, starts, like periodical process. However, it's very sensitive. If you change parameters, in this case it was parameters of coupling between SAS4A code and CIMR code, you can have either immediately secondary power excursion, which destroys this core very quickly, showing power, you see, in red, which could be up to 500 of the nominal power peaks, or you can have a stabilization of the process simply without any boiling on this, shown in the blue line. I'm showing this because it shows how complicated could be these effects. And also, especially if you do it for the new reactors and you try to find out the technical solutions how to prevent this, still numerical simulation shows that several possibilities possible. Because you see this sensitivity analysis shows that we don't know exactly. We cannot say what would happen in the reality. And we should consider all the variants. And unfortunately, in this case, we could, maybe it's not very realistic, but we should be conservative in this case, that it could be happen that still this will not help us to prevent the core meltdown and other things. However, these results were like, it's not, how to say, the final answer, of course, but because we don't know, the code should be, you cannot validate such systems complicated on the real situations because we don't have experimental data. And I hope we will never have such kind of experimental data for the fast reactors or whatever reactors as well. But this is very complicated problem that cannot be solved, and we should work. And then on the design stage, we should demonstrate that our reactor can do this and this, and if in case of accident, we could this. So it was actually wrong timing. So it should be for the coffee break. Okay. And to help our member states in validating and verifying their numerical simulation codes and models, IEA organize on the regular basis so-called CRPs or coordinated research projects or benchmarks on different aspects of this kind of system, and most of them are simulations of the reactors, transit, and so on. This slide shows the recently finished in 2016 benchmark that was CRP that was conducted for years, and it's benchmark analysis of the EBR2 shutdown heat removal test. So that time, on the EBR-II, it was it's a relatively old reactor. It's very interesting and very complicated system. It's mix of pool and the loop type, actually. It's pool type reactor with coolant circulating in loops inside, I would say. And from the upper, from the lower part, it's actually the pool type, but from the outlet, it's connected through the Z-pipe, so it's actually a loop pipe reactor. So the purpose of, and they conducted this test in INL for to prove that reactor can survive severe accident. It was like, I know, maybe 40 years ago or more. Finally, those experimental data became available, and INL decided to open to provide this data for the community and for the IAEA to conduct the serious experiments. The purpose of this CRP was like, it happens like, okay, first we define the configuration, define the experiment, and whatever happens, where we had thermocouples, what was measured, what was not, but also the initial conditions, boundary conditions, as much as possible. And then participants start blind calculus simulations. So they model the core, whatever model they have, with whatever simulation code they have. And then after, let's say, about 1 year of simulation, they gather together again and compare the results. Compare the results for between each other and versus experimental data. Then, at this stage, the experimental data, the results of the experiments are disclosed and you can compare. And here, this I put just on one slide several slots. So you see, this specific test shutdown test number 17, which was connected to the, it was protected loss of normal and emergency pumping, but with protected. And you see this like many, it's about 20 or maybe, I believe it's 15 simulations of this code, and the results are compared with each other and with experimental data as well. So then, basically, after that first comparison and analysis, participants would refine their models. Maybe they would choose another code, or they introduce another model, or update their models, what they're using in the simulation of such accidents, and then compare the results finally again. And we have like document which describes the experiment, what was done, and what. And actually, this document provides a good, very good base. If somebody wants to validate a new code, a new model, they would take this document, repeat the simulations, and compare, and that would be very good case of the validation. That's how we try to improve and share the knowledge on this technique, on this complicated, sophisticated computer code symmetology for the, our member states. Okay, that is another slide on the EBAR shutdown heat removal test. So it's another, it was one protected loss of flow and unprotected loss of flow. But however, it was, screen was disabled, station blackout, but it was an additional pump, auxiliary pump that still was working, so it was not classical ELOF with all loss of, with complete loss of coolant, but it was some calculation. So, and this slide again shows the experimental data calculated for different temperatures, and then again, one example of comparison of the participant data of UC. We have many calculations, very wide range. Some of the source of the discrepancy could be simply error in the input data, because it's very complicated system, as I say, you should model very carefully geometry and other many, many other things, and any mistake, of course, in this could lead to the discrepancy of the results. But not only that, of course, you should different codes, use different models, even within the same code, you can use different models, different meshing, you know, whatever. There are many, many things that can affect the results, and the task this was to compare, not to say that this was not to, let's say, assign the best available performing code. In this case, of course, INL has better result because they knew in advance the result of the experiment and they did this calculation well before. But it was just compare and give the participants possibility to improve to refine their models, and also to give the, for the, let's say, to share this all experience with other possible participants, not participants, but for the people who are developing such codes and need this experimental results for validation, for validation of their codes. And that was successful CRP, which was published, and we published a TikTok, and I believe it was very successful CRP. Everybody were happy, and especially under the INL, Aragon National Laboratory was really leading the CRP, organizing, and it's, it was a very good example of organization and joint work on this benchmark problem. Now we started two new CRPs this year, and one of them is another, same, ULOV, benchmark analysis of FFTF loss of flow without Scrum test. It's how they call LOFST, but usual name is ULOV, but since the original test was loss of flow without Scrum, so we did it, keep this name for this CRP, but it is simple. FFTF is fast flux test facility in the PNL. Now it's not in decommissioning, but still innovating, but can be restarted in operation on this time. But it was stopped like, I don't know, 20 years ago, about, and like 30 years ago, they had some experiments. So this reactor was a prototype of the SFR, which is 400 megawatts thermal, sodium-cooled fast reactors of the pool type, because low power is lower. And it works on the MOX fuel, mixed uranium and plutonium dioxide. And it's loop type with axial and radial reflectors. And the total volume of the core about 1 cubic meter small, and with 90 only centimeter height, and diameter is like 120. Actually, fissile core is very small for the fast reactors. And one of the features, because we need the high neutron flux, and we need then it results in the higher power options, of course, and then we have higher power density. It's several times higher than, let's say, water reactors, and one order of magnitude higher than, let's say, high temperature graphite reactors, and so on. So, and to demonstrate the safety features of this reactor, FFTF, they did several experimentals on the ULOV, or loss of flow without Scrum test. And at that time, they already implemented the passive safety system, which is gas expansion model. Interesting system, like say, if you have lower flow, you insert more gas, and I will not go into detail, but and the purpose of this particular test was to demonstrate that this passive shutdown system works well. Okay. And so the test was, it's one of the many tests, but we received data on this particular test. The reactor was working on the nominal power, or 50% of the nominal power, and main coolant pumps were turned off, and normal control Scrum response was disabled. So then more or less you see the results of the experiment. Ah, okay, this is not. So, and temperatures were reached somehow the maximal values, but it was still within the margins of the safety limits, and thanks to this GEM, gas expansion model passive shutdown system, reactor was safely shut down without exceeding safety margin. However, let's say, notice that it's at 50% power, and I believe it, if they start from 100%, it would be not very successful in this case. Of course, they had some, let's say, if temperature would reach some, you know, unsafe values or limits, they would shut down the reactor anyway. But in this case, the reactor was not shut down. It was, I mean, by contour roads, it was shut down automatically, but thanks to this gas inspection model passive system. So more or less, you see here, shows the coolant temperature. It was rising and then going down, and compares it with Rhapsody, which was, by the way, they compare it with something. And the result is that coolant temperature never reached the boiling limit, and it was, I mean, good demonstration. So now it's, and that we don't have boiling, it's very good, because once you have boiling, the solving of the problem becomes much more complicated and very, oops, another thing, and it's uncertain, and the results becomes very uncertain, because it's very complicated physical phenomenon. In this case, and nevertheless, even in this case, it's very complicated task, how to find, how to simulate this system properly, accurately, using only this input data. And we had already first meeting we will have first, but already we have specification, and we, in October, we'll have a first meeting where the participants, which is like about 25 organizations from 15 or 17 countries, are participating now. When participants will discuss, decide what they actually need, how to model, to find some general common solution, and then go go for their blind simulation for the first year. And just in addition, I would like to show you the another CRP which we started. It's not ELOF and not transient analysis, but it's Neutronic benchmarks of CFR startup test. It's pure Neutronics, but people will use Monte Carlo and deterministic codes. Relative, it's standard task, relatively easy. I say relatively because it's not easy at all. But since many countries, many organizations, and many participants have great experience in simulating of such kind of, let's say, only Neutronics, you don't have to simulate coupled with thermal hydraulics or whatever. So this is, I expect this, we could receive a good results. And what you need experience in Neutronic simulation, and many people, let's say, and I believe your organizations you're representing are also several participating in this CRP. And it's another example of CRP we have. And what important, already Chirayu on the first day, or he explained that we are to, you know, that the idea of the CRP is to collect data, experimental data, to have a benchmark, and then to provide for the future users this set of data so you can repeat this experiment and simulate this, I mean, not repeat experiment, sorry, but simulate this, repeat the simulation of this experiment and compare your result, your future models with this data. However, if you have only book with very, very complicated specification, it's not always easy. That's why we are in support of this, let's say, on participants now and for future, we're developing so-called digital nuclear reactor. It's a storage of the data on the core and on the reactor, which helps the users, as Chira explained it also already, to calculate. And we have this already for the CFR startup benchmark, and we're planning to have it also for the FFTF reactor core, at least. I just want to note one more thing, which I forgotten in my first presentation, and maybe useful for you, within the NAPRA CRP, sodium properties, we will issue not only textbooks or handbooks on sodium properties, which includes physical and chemical sodium properties and friction factors and heat transfer coefficients for the sodium coolants, but also online sodium properties calculator. When you can, now it's, there is a working version, maybe we can also check how it works. It allows you to use all relations included in those handbooks will be also included in the system, so you can easily see the results, obtain the result, see the comparison, and also you can extract the computer code, I mean the code exactly, which can be used in your models for the modeling in your computer. This is Java, I believe, and it should be also easily converted to C programs as well. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and that's all of my presentation. We'll be happy to see if anybody wants to ask questions.